फतेहगढ़ साहिब। आई गुरप्रीत कौर टेक ग्रेट प्राइड इन वेलकमिंग ऑल द अटेंडीज एंड कीनोट स्पीकर ऑफ सेकेंड सेशन ऑफ द वर्कशॉप डॉक्टर कविता दोराई फ्रॉम आईसर मोहाली। द मेन मोटिव ऑफ टूडेज सेशन इज टू डिस्कस द वेरियस फैक्ट अबाउट द एनएमआर स्पेक्ट्रोस्कोपी एंड इट्स एप्लीकेशन इन बायोलॉजी। I am highly optimistic that this valuable talk will pave the way to the participants for the clear understanding of several aspects of NMR spectroscopy. Although Dr. Kavita Dorai does not require any introduction, but still I would like to share with you people that she has done her PhD from IISc Bangalore. In addition to, Dr. Kavita has also worked as a research associate in the University of Frankfurt, Germany, University of Dortmund, Germany, and Mellon University in USA. She is currently working as professor in ICER Mohali and as the convener of the NMR research facility. She is an eminent NMR spectroscopist whose research interests include NMR quantum computics, NMR of nanomaterials and biomolecular structure, and NMR-based metabolomics. She has demonstrated various biomarkers which are responsible for the onset of diabetes through NMR metabolomics. Moreover, her research has been well recognized through several awards, and she has received various projects funded through DST, DBT, and CSIR. Dr. Kavita is also a prestigious author of number of publications in reputed journals and books. She has delivered many talks as a resource person in various institutes at national and international level. Now, without any delay, I request Dr. Kavita to deliver her talk.
Okay, great. First of all, a very good morning to everybody. And I'm really delighted and honored to be speaking in this workshop. I thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. And it's wonderful to see academic activity post-lockdown has begun. I'll just share my slides. So let me try that. How do I share slides in this?
Ma'am, in your presentation, you can see the icon you are presenting now.
Yeah.
Yeah, ma'am, when you click that icon.
Okay.
Then you can go in the Chrome tab. When you click the Chrome tab, you can go... you can open your presentation.
Chrome tab. I don't see your Chrome.
Chrome tab or your front window.
Dr. Kavita?
Yes?
On your right-hand side, bottom corner, there will be three dots available.
Yeah, I can see that.
Yeah. In that, along with that, to the next, there is a present option. When you go to present,
okay, it says zoology department is presenting
next to the three dots on the left. To the three dots, there is an icon,
it says
similar box,
right? Okay,
yes, when you click that, it will say present.
Okay, yeah, and then it says a Chrome tab.
Then it says, it gives you an option, either a tab or a window.
Okay.
So choose where you have opened your presentation. Choose that window.
Okay, I'll do that.
And then it'll say, click on that and share. Yeah, it'll say share. When you click on share, it will start sharing. Yes, ma'am, you are presenting now. You just have to go to the your presentation window now. Where okay. Your PPT is open.
I've gone to my presentation window. Is that visible? Are my slides visible?
Ma'am, you are in the Meet window. You have to go to your presentation window, to your presentation, PPT.
Yeah, I've gone to my presentation.
You can use the Alt tab, Alt tab, and then you can stop on that particular PPT.
Which tab, sorry?
Alt plus tab. Alt plus tab.
Okay, let me try that.
Simultaneously pressing Alt and Tab, you can move to different tabs.
Nope.
Okay, your presentation is open in its PPT form, PowerPoint presentation.
It's a PDF.
It's a PDF.
Yeah.
Okay. Your PDF is open in this Chrome window?
No, not really. It's there on my desktop. Okay. Shall I open?
Yes. Then you can go to that PDF.
Okay.
Just click on your PDF and it will be visible to the audience.
Mm-hmm. Nope, that doesn't seem to work.
Okay, fine. Just go back, stop presenting.
Yeah.
Again, go to present.
Yeah.
In that, present your whole window option will be there. Again, go back to there.
Yeah. It says entire screen. Shall I do that?
Yes, entire screen, and then you will be opening your PDF, Adobe window, okay. In which your PDF is lying. Just okay. Open that Adobe window.
Okay. Nope, that doesn't.
Your screen is being shared. Your screen is being presented. You just have to open your Adobe PDF file.
Okay.
Your screen is visible to us. You just have to open your. Yes.
Yes. It's visible now.
Yes.
Okay. It's visible, ma'am.
Okay. Great. Wonderful. So so let me begin since we've lost a little bit of time. I'm going to talk to you about the basics of NMR and applications to chemistry and biology. And I thought that I will focus on NMR applications to metabolomics because it's the new kid on the omics block. So, but before we do that, let me begin with NMR. So NMR, N stands for nuclear, M stands for magnetic, and R stands for resonance. So what does that mean? Physically, one can think of a nucleus as having a magnetic moment. It's like a small magnetic top which is spinning on its axis. Ignore the mu equal to gamma I h cross. That is just a way of quantifying the spin because we all know that our world is quantum mechanical. So even nuclear spins are quantum mechanical objects. Once they're placed, so then we come to, that's the N part of NMR. What's the M? The M stands for magnetic field. So what happens when one places a collection or an ensemble of these nuclear spins in a magnetic field? At the moment, I have projected the magnetic field B0 in the positive Z direction. What happens to these spins is they start precessing around the magnetic field. So they don't just rotate, they kind of precess. They were rotating around the axis and now they precess in a cone around the magnetic field, and they do so at a very precise frequency. The frequency is called the Lama frequency after the physicist who discovered this fact. And so you can see down there, I've written the Lama frequency omega is gamma times B0. So in some sense, the frequency at which, or the speed at which these spins precess or rotate about the axes depends on the strength of a magnetic field. Gamma is just a proportionality constant, which is, you know, a signature of the kind of nuclei. So you can have different kinds of nuclei, proton, carbon-13, phosphorus, fluorine, and what have you. All of these have an intrinsic spin magnetic moment, and hence they are NMR active in some sense. So like I said, the speed at which these nuclei spin, these small little, you know, molecular magnets, if you please, depends on the magnetic field. The higher you go, the higher field you apply, the faster they process. And there's just one tiny little thing that we have to remember, that they can also orient themselves. So if you look at that black arrow that I have over there, around this little magnetic dot, along this magnetic little ball, which denotes the nuclear spin, this magnetic moment can be oriented either parallel, so along the positive z direction, along the magnetic field, applied magnetic field, or it can be anti-parallel. Now, those spins, when placed in this magnetic field, which are parallel, which are oriented along the magnetic field, they just have a lower energy. And we all know that, you know, all spins, everything in nature wants to get back to lower energy, wants to get back to what is called ground state. So, though there is a slight excess orientation of spins along the magnetic field, you know, they sort of preferentially want to align along the magnetic field. And all of this has been proved experimentally. So people have done lots of precise experiments to actually measure how many spins, given an ensemble, given say an 10 to the power 23 spins, how many of them will precess along the magnetic field and how many will precess anti-parallel to the magnetic field, right? So now we come to the concept of R. What is resonance? So resonance, as some of you might remember from your college undergrad physics, is a phenomenon where an object derives energy, or energy is pumped into a system from something else which is resonating at the same frequency. So what frequency is that? Remember, here we're talking about the Lama frequency. So we have a collection of these nuclear spins. They're all processing around their intrinsic, magnetic moment directions. Some of them are oriented parallel to the magnetic field. Some of them are oriented anti-parallel. And then what happens? You hit the system with some quantum of energy. And remember that E is proportional to B in this case. And I said there are two energy states, right? Energy configurations of these nuclear spins, ones which are oriented up and ones which are oriented down. So imagine that those which are in the lower energy state, when they get hit by a quantum of energy, and this is done typically through a radio frequency field. So, and when an oscillating radio frequency field hits this ensemble of nuclear spins, those that are there oriented parallel to the magnetic field, they absorb a certain quantum of energy. And what is that quantum of energy? That corresponds to their precise Lama frequencies. And then they absorb this energy and they jump up to the higher energy configuration, which is the one where they are oriented anti-parallel to the field. And when that happens, you know, after some time, everything goes back to equilibrium. Everything wants to relax. So any physical system, this is true for any physical system. So after a certain time, whatever excess energy they've absorbed from the outside applied radio frequency field, they give off this energy to their environment and they come back to ground state. And that energy that they give off, which they've picked up at resonance, that is what is the NMR signal. So we have a whole lot of very sophisticated RF electronics, which it's typically called the receiver coil. And that is what comes and is emitted from this ensemble of spins. And that is what we measure. And that is what is the NMR signal. So that's what I've written over there. There's a transmitter coil, you pump in energy, there's resonance, it's applied at the Lama frequency omega zero. The total magnetization, remember I told you there was an excess of spins oriented along. So all of them had the nuclear magnetic moments mu, and all of that adds up to this arrow which I've drawn here, denoted M0. And when the energy is pumped in, this magnetization vector tips from the orientation along the Z direction to the XY plane. And then when it relaxes back to equilibrium, back to the Z direction, it gives off energy, and that is the NMR signal. So that's what I've written. So I have a receiver coil which is wrapped around this precessing magnetization in the XY plane. And when the MXY magnetization vector is going to go back after some time to the Z direction, it gives off this energy, and that's my NMR signal. Okay, this is a block diagram of an NMR spectrometer. So that's the sample. Here the B0 is not oriented along Z, it's oriented along the XY direction. But never mind, you can, you know, turn this picture upside down and get a feel for it. So what does one do? One has a magnet. Usually these days it's a superconducting magnet with a very, very high magnetic field. There's a frequency generator which creates an AC at omega zero that induces an oscillating RF. That's the B1 field. And then one picks up the signal, detects the signal, and then records it. Okay. The quantum mechanical picture for those of you who are physicists is that there is an energy gap. And like I said, between the two energy configurations, and like I said, this gap increases with increasing energy, with increasing magnetic field, right? Because delta E, the difference between the two energy levels, is proportional to B0. And you can see that for B0 in Tesla, the frequency is in the RF range. So around 10 to hundreds of megahertz, the same like your radio, okay? The same frequency of your radio. This is not the whole story. So, you know, if I had all the spins resonating exactly at the Lama frequency, then I'll just get one NMR signal, one line, which doesn't really give me any information. I mean, it's interesting to the physicists, but not really to the chemists and the biologists, because, you know, what do you do with just one peak, one signal? Interestingly enough, or happily enough for the chemists and the biologists, there's an effect in NMR called the chemical shift. So what happens is that each spin, because of its surrounding electron cloud, which is different for different kinds of molecules. So if you have a benzene molecule, there are six protons, all of them have an equivalent chemical shift. But if you replace one of the protons by a fluorine and another of the protons by a phosphorus, then the chemical environment around these protons changes, it shifts. And that leads to a shift in the frequency. So now where you had just one line, now you will have several different lines. Okay. And that is why NMR is interesting, and that's why NMR. And each peak will give you information about that particular spin and its environment. So that can be used for structure elucidation. There's also another effect in place, which is called the nuclear Oberhauser effect, or the NOE, which gives you distance information. So I had previously told you about the chemical shift, which tells you this about differences in frequency, Lama frequencies that happens. And there's another effect which also gives you precise distance information. And this is very, very interesting for molecular biologists who want to talk about, you know, protein structure or structure of any kind of large biomolecule. And this proceeds through an effect called spin relaxation, which I will not get into the details of, but those of you who are interested can always, you know, talk to me later. Also, of course, there's another interesting effect which uses gradients, so a graded magnetic field. And this gradation in the magnetic field can be transformed into getting an image of the object which is under study. Okay, and this is the exact principle behind MRI, or magnetic resonance imaging. It's the same physics, and just that the application is different. Okay. Now, you know, like I said, each signal, each spin, each nuclear spin in the sample, it could be a really complicated molecule, it could be a supramolecule, it could be a biomolecule, you know, all of these, they have a distinctive signature. And this could lead to thousands of lines. And if one really wanted to explore the molecule, then the chemist or the biologist or the physicist would have to, you know, at each specific Lama frequency, go line by line, hit the system with that particular energy of that particular frequency, record the spectrum, record the NMR line, and then go and then move on. And this could take like hours or even days to do so. So what really revolutionized the field was a chemist called Professor Richard Ernst from ETH Zurich, who won the Nobel in chemistry for this particular discovery or this particular method. He developed something called a Fourier transform, which kind of encapsulates the information in time. So you see, we have a signal in time, which is oscillating at the Lama frequency. And taking a Fourier transform of that gives you the signal in the frequency domain, which is all those resonance lines. So in some sense, imagine the NMR spectrum to be the NMR system of nuclear spins to be like the keys of a piano. Okay, so in the old days of NMR, one would have to press a piano key, it would resonate, there'd be one particular audio signal at a particular frequency, then you'd record that, and that would be one line. And then you'd go on to the next key, and the next key, and the next key, and so on. But imagine that if instead of doing that, you in time somehow you press all the keys. So you just smash your fist down on the entire piano and you're able to record all the signals from all the spins or all the piano keys at once. And then later on you do some mathematical transformation. These days it's done by the computer, so that you decode all the signals that are in there. Okay. So that's exactly what the Fourier transform does. That's the piano analogy. It doesn't quite work like that, but you know, for our purposes, we can think of it that way. So, like I said, that's the blue lines on the right. They are the NMR spectrum, and on the left, I have the NMR signal, which is decaying in time and oscillating at the Lama frequency. I take a Fourier transform, and so there are typically hundreds of spins, maybe even thousands, and so hundreds of resonance frequencies. And what the combination of all these signals, which is received by the receiver coil, is called the FID or the free induction decay. Okay, decay because it decays, induction because it's induced, and free because it's left free. Okay. And the Fourier transform of this FID gives you the NMR spectrum. Typically, like I said, you know, this is recording in one dimension. So I have the signal intensity, all those lines, along the y direction, and on the x axis I have ppm, which is just a frequency scale. Okay, so this really, you know, there are just too many peaks, too many overlaps, it's just too complex to interpret. And one doesn't, again, you know, one has the information, it's very complicated, and the information because of the Fourier transform has been got very fast, but one can't really do much about it. So then people came up with different techniques, and the next step is a two-dimensional experiment. Imagine it like a stack of one-dimensional NMR data files. One just changes the time, the T1 increment. You can see between the two radio frequency pulses. What do I mean by RF pulses? Remember I told you have to pump in energy into the system at a particular frequency, and those are those little, you know, rectangles that I have over there. Let's not worry about what's written on top of each rectangle, but that's the kind of energy that is pulsed or pumped into, and that's why it's called an RF pulse. RF because it's a radio frequency pulse, okay, of excitation. So I can use a set of pulses, and believe me, an NMR experiment in two dimensions, three dimensions, n dimensions can have literally hundreds and hundreds of pulses. And finally, all you get is the FID. And then you Fourier transform it, and then you can begin to make sense of the information. So this is typically after Fourier transforming the signal from a two-dimensional experiment, COSY is correlation spectroscopy. These are the kind of peaks that one gets. And you can see there are, you know, four peaks, two yellow peaks, one blue and one red. And the it's the yellow peak which is really of interest in the top spectrum, because that's what gives you which spin is correlated or which spin is coupled to which spin in the spectrum. Similarly, like I said before, one can have frequency information, one can also have distance information. And this is really the you know, one of the most famous experiments in the world. It is the first two-dimensional experiment in NMR spectrum of a small protein called BPTI. And this was actually recorded by my PhD boss, Professor Anil Kumar. And it's a really, really famous experiment and a famous spectrum, because for the first time, the biologists, till now, you know, NMR was a game for the physicists and the chemists, but in the early 1980s, the biologists kind of came to find that, you know, NMR as a technique sometimes gives you as equivalent information or even more information than other techniques like X-ray. Okay, so then one can unravel. Imagine there are literally thousands and thousands of peaks, but one could at that point use just this one spectrum and get to the molecular structure, the three-dimensional structure of that protein. So I'm now going to shift to, you know, all the various areas in science that NMR can be applied to. So NMR, of course, has ubiquitous applications in chemistry. For example, if you make something in the lab and it blows up, so you take an NMR signature of whatever of the constituents of your blow up, and you can find out, you know, what were the molecules in there. NMR is very much used in by pharma companies for drug design strategies, because, you know, as you all know, being biology students, that every molecule, every protein has a particular, has sites where ligands or small ligands or small molecules like drugs go and bind. And that is the way their mechanism of action works, right? So it's like having a lock and several different keys to fit it. So one particular key could go and fit that binding site or could go and dock. Now, one typically in an NMR drug design or drug binding experiment, what happens is that the pharmaceutical NMR scientist, you know, has this protein and throws several candidate drug molecules, which he or she has synthesized in the lab at this. And then using NMR, one can see, okay, this guy has bound to this particular binding site with 70% probability. And one can actually, you know, make this very precise. And it's because, you know, finding new drugs which act the way you want them to is a very expensive process. And this is a, you know, quick and accurate way. NMR is a quick and accurate way of doing this. One can have NMR applications in geophysics. For instance, this has been done. This, what you see up there in the top picture, is an actual NMR spectrometer which was ported to the Antarctica, and it was used to study brine pockets or saltwater pockets in sea ice, right? And the picture below is another field NMR spectrometer which has been used to look for petroleum deposits deep in the ground. If one wanted to, and this is especially true in places like Punjab where the groundwater is being depleted, one can use such an portable NMR machine to profile the table, the groundwater table in the region. And then one can also get information about the pollutants that are there, which could be due to pesticides or other environmental pollutants. Of course, like I said in the beginning, NMR of materials, material scientists are increasingly using NMR. So if you have nanotubes, nanomaterials, you can actually get a picture of the dynamics of water which is flowing in the nanotube. Or you can look at how the self-assembly of various kinds of molecules like ionic polyelectrolytes and ionic liquids, which are actually, you know, increasingly being suggested as candidates for solar cells these days. NMR and food technology, if you really wanted to know, you know, is your expensive wine actually champagne, or does it have, is it just vinegar, or is your fine whiskey polluted with something else? All of that can be found using NMR. NMR in physics, of course, there are lots and lots of applications. The most recent one is something that I also work with, which is quantum computing, but I won't talk about that in this talk. For instance, if you wanted to know the rheology of a complex fluid, what is a complex fluid? Something that doesn't follow Newtonian dynamics, okay? So it's non-Newtonian in nature. And there are very many interesting compounds which are complex fluids these days. And NMR can tell you about their phase flow, about their relaxation properties, and so on. Another place where NMR, like I mentioned early on, you know, one could use a graded magnetic field to separate frequency information into spatial information. And this is now, you know, there's been a Nobel Prize for this as well. And so NMR as a biomedical imaging technique, or magnetic resonance imaging, it's the same thing. It's just that people in those days were very scared of the word nuclear. So the doctors decided, instead of calling it NMR imaging, they would instead call it MR imaging. Okay, so they just cut the word nuclear, but it's the physics is exactly the same. And using that, you know, I don't know if there's anybody in the audience who's actually been inside, who's had an MRI scan done or a whole body scan done. So I have shown an MRI image of the human brain, and right next to that is the machine which takes the image. So you go inside the machine. I haven't been in one yet, but a couple of my friends have, and they tell me that it's quite a scary experience. Because you keep hearing the noise or the music of the magnets, as I call it. But anyway, all that information, just pumping in frequency into the system, exciting water molecules. So what all MRI images image, what do they image? They basically image the water, and then that gets converted into a digitally processed image of whichever body part. So one can find out how worn out is a knee cartilage. These days there are other dynamic MRI techniques in place. So one can pretty much image any kind of soft tissue, and it's completely non-invasive. So it does not damage soft tissue, unlike X-ray and other techniques which are harmful. MRI is completely safe and completely non-invasive. So that's why a lot of doctors and medical practitioners prefer to have MRI as an imaging technique of their choice. Then one can have fMRI or functional MRI, because, you know, I believe, and lots of scientists believe, that the most complex system in existence today is the human brain. And how do we think, how do we imagine, how do we dream, how do we, all these cognitive processes that neuroscientists have thought about for over a century now, functional MRI can actually help you do this. So this is part of a study where they wanted to study how London taxi drivers, you know, how do they map their routes? It's a very non-linear process, because just in case there's a traffic diversion somewhere, they have to quickly remap their routes. Now you ask Google Maps to do it for you, but they actually had a competition, and they showed that, you know, that some of the very experienced taxi drivers were able to map their routes much faster, alternative routes much faster than even Google Maps. So that's something interesting. And there are many such functional MRI studies. NMR in biology, of course, I showed you the first 2D NOSI of a small protein, but now you can do all kinds of biological studies with NMR. Of course, three-dimensional structure of a protein. You can take snapshots using NMR of a protein folding pathway. You can get information about metabolites and biofluids, which I will talk about slightly later. And you can pretty much do, you know, a lot with NMR in structural biology. So it's a major technique for those who do want to do further research in biophysics or biotechnology. NMR is definitely a technique which you should get familiar with. this is one, just a slide I threw in here to tell you that NMR can also tell you about dynamics of a protein. And this was a study that I was involved with Professor Walter Chesa, where he was studying human replication protein. It's a single-stranded DNA binding protein. And you can see these wiggly bits at the end. So we used NMR cross-correlation to look at the inter-domain dynamics. So, you know, what happens exactly when the DNA is... So if in the whole DNA repair machinery, once the DNA starts to get unraveled by several proteins, this guy, RPA, goes and binds to that single strand. So as soon as the double-stranded DNA starts unraveling, this guy goes and binds to it. And the binding site was known, but exactly the dynamics of this was not known. So we, you know, did a little bit to find out using cross-correlated spin relaxation NMR. And this was a pretty nice study. Now I come to, you know, all the Nobel Prizes. So you can see that the game has been changing. So in 1902, Zeeman got the physics Nobel for actually discovering the spectral splitting. Remember I told you that a collection of spins can have two orientations, so a higher energy and a lower energy configuration. And actually the difference is called the Zeeman splitting, after Zeeman. Then, of course, the discovery that proton is a quantum mechanical object and has a magnetic moment, a nuclear magnetic moment, that got the Nobel. Then the fact that they have magnetic properties, that got the physics Nobel in 1944. And then in 1952, really, Bloch and Purcell, who were two American physicists, one on the East Coast, one on the West Coast, jointly got the Nobel for independently discovering that. So they actually stuck a tube of water into, wrapped a coil around it, RF coil, and stuck it into a magnetic field and saw the first NMR signal. I've already told you about the chemistry Nobel to Professor Ernst. Then in the chemistry Nobel again went to Professor Guthrie, but this was for three-dimensional structures of proteins. So it was really a biology Nobel. But you know, as you know, biology doesn't have a separate Nobel Prize. And then in 2003, Mansfield and Lauterberg got the medicine Nobel for their discovery of and contributions to magnetic resonance imaging. So I think the Nobel journey has just begun, and there are many more discoveries using NMR and its utility to science, which will come on. And in the future, you know, what are the various things? So one that is definitely going to happen is, instead of these huge NMR spectrometers that one currently has, it's going to be miniaturized. And we might even have NMR on a small chip, which you can carry around in your mobile phone, for instance. And different detection techniques, definitely using lasers and optically driven techniques, that's going to be part of the future. Now I'm going to switch gears and tell you about a recent application of NMR to an entire field of science, which is called metabolomics. So what is the idea? The idea is that if one has an organism, it could be anything, an insect, an animal, a human being, okay, a plant, its response to stimulus is very complex. And the stimulus could be anything. It could be drought in the case of a plant. It could be a disease in the case of a human being. It could be a physical stimulus in the case of an insect. The way the organism responds to this environmental stress, if you please, is very complex. And if you use a singular diagnostic parameter, that gives you a very incomplete picture of its response. So like you have genomics, which is a study of the genes, proteomics, which is a study of proteins. Now there's a new kid on the omics block, which is called metabolomics. And what does it study? It studies changes at the level of metabolites, and then mathematically models these changes to give a complete picture of the stimulus response of the organism. Now you might say, what are metabolites? Okay, so you all know what genes are, okay? And genes express proteins, and proteins do various various functions. They perform various functions in the organism. And when they do these, so proteins are pretty much responsible for all kinds of biological processes. And when they do these processes, it could be digestion, it could be breathing, respiratory, reproduction, whatever. So once they do this, they you know, as a byproduct, they express several small molecules, so which are called metabolites. So metabolites are, you know, downstream. They're released into various body biofluids like sweat or blood or urine, okay? And they kind of give you a signature of that biological process. So it's a systems biology approach, and one can use metabolites, or actually not just one metabolite, but several hundred metabolites. Many of them are expressed in thousands, okay? And they all have an NMR signature. So there are these small molecules which are present in blood or urine or serum or whatever. And if one can map the changes that happens once the organism has a disease, okay, then one can identify biomarkers of the biological state of the organism. And to give you clue, this is going to be, so we are moving into the era of personalized medicine or nanomedicine. And metabolomics will really help in that, because, you know, we all know that if a person develops, say, diabetes type 2, okay, one sure out whether a person has these or not, blood sugar level, okay, and pre-fasting and post-fasting. But this is after the person has developed diabetes. Whereas if one takes a metabolomics test, okay, of the urine or the blood of a patient who's at high risk for diabetes, okay, and what is diabetes? It's just a dysregulation of certain biological processes, the metabolome of the human being, right? So if one is able to look at certain, first of all, one has to see what to look for, which metabolites are signatures of diabetes. But if one is able to do that, and then one takes a kind of fingerprint of that person's metabolome, okay, and then the doctor can tell him or her, look, unless you do make these lifestyle changes, or unless you do this, this, and this, you are at risk to develop diabetes. So even before, and this is not just for diabetes, now metabolomics is increasingly being used to for other diagnosis of other diseases, including cardiovascular, breast cancer, kidney diseases. There are lots and lots of diseases that now come under the purview of metabolomics. And there are only two techniques currently existing which can perform metabolomic studies. NMR is one, and mass spectrometry is the other. So there are, like I said, there are broad areas of applications of metabolomic studies. I told you about systems biology, I told you about disease diagnostics. One can use it for environmental science, food science. One can use it to map the plant metabolome. And my focus is on using NMR metabolomics and to use it for bioprospecting, human disease, and evolutionary biology. And I'll give you a few examples of what we've done in my lab in two of these areas, which is bioprospecting and evolutionary biology. Okay, this I've already told you about, that how NMR can help in disease metabolomics. Now I come to a study which I did with a colleague of mine in a collaboration with Professor Uma Shankar from GKVK University, Bangalore. And he's a plant biologist, and he's very interested in finding out plant sources for anti-cancer drugs. So one such anti-cancer alkaloid is camptothecin, which I call CPT. And he and his team found, so right now the plant sources known were all from China. And Professor Uma Shankar, he's done a lot of biodiversity mapping in Karnataka. And he found that in northern Karnataka, there's a plant called Mapia plant, which is a very good source of camptothecin. Okay. And then while, you know, doing this bio prospecting, he discovered that there's a particular beetle, and this mapia plant, the leaves are so toxic that, you know, nothing eats them. They have no, this plant does not have a predator. And that's because, you know, camptothecin is extremely toxic. It of course kills the cancer cells, but it kills, you know, it's highly toxic. So they found that, you know, nothing really denuded these leaves, mapia leaves, nothing ate them. And they actually fed some fighter ants these mapia leaves because they didn't give them any other source. And as soon as the ants, you know, these are like really ferocious ants, as soon as the ants ate the leaves, they died. So then they discovered that there's a particular beetle, and you can see the small yellow beetle. It's a chrysomelid beetle, and its diet, it feeds only on these mapia leaves. So the question was, you know, it somehow, and it survives, and it actually, you know, it kind of occupies a particular very specific ecological niche in the forests of Karnataka, because, you know, it doesn't have any competition. Nothing else eats those mapia leaves, and it's the only predator for those leaves. So Umashankar wanted to ask the question, you know, somehow it's able to withstand such a hugely poisonous alkaloid, plant alkaloid. So how does it do so? You know, what happens to the CPT, the camptothecin that the beetle ingests? Does it biotransform it to something which is less toxic? Or does it sequester it? That means, does it store it? And if so, why does it store it? And if it biotransforms it, can we, you know, find out what is the process by which it changes toxic CPT to a less toxic CPT? Because then we can use that in making these anti-cancer drugs less toxic. So this is, and he, while doing this study, he also found that, you know, he found a particular moth larva, which also feeds on the mapia leaf. And we found a beetle, which is similar, but it does not feed on the mapia leaf. So we did all these experiments, prepared samples for NMR for the larvae from the blood and the excreta, and for both types of beetles in the body, head, excreta, and hindwing. And the question we wanted to ask from the NMR point of view was that, can we identify CPT and its derivatives both from the plant source as well as from all these insect sources? And is it sequestered or biotransformed? And if it is it sequestered preferentially? So that's all the NMR spectra. We did a lot of multivariate statistical analysis. I'll not go into the details of that, but we found that they don't biotransform, the beetles do not biotransform CPT into a less toxic form. They actually sequester it, and they sequester it in the wings as compared to the body. So the question that was asked was, how do they tolerate CPT? The answer was sequestration. And again, the question was, why do they do so? And the answer was, of course, to deter predators. Because, you know, whoever eats these beetles, that predator dies. So the beetles, the predators also know, you know, to leave these beetles alone. So it's a very interesting, very complex chain that exists, that the plant has actually secreted this very poisonous alkaloid to protect itself against predators. But there's a predator beetle, which is co-evolved with the plant, is able to ingest this toxic alkaloid and use it to deter its own predators. So it's really, you know, the specificity of insect, plant-insect interactions is extremely important. As just a little side remark, I'll tell you a funny story. So Umashankar he and his team go into the forest, they have to depend on, because most of us live in cities, so we have to depend on field guides who are usually tribal people from that area. And he was talking to one of the tribal people who was helping him, the guide, and he was telling me, no, we did this very big study and a lot of machines, and then we found that this beetle actually, you know, And the tribal said, oh, very interesting. Actually, you know, we know this for a very long time. For hundreds of years, we know this because we always we crush the beetle leaves, wings, and we use them, you know, we scatter it over rice grains when we want to store them for the winter for long storage. And, you know, that's how we protect grains. So Uma Shankar and I were laughing that, you know, we don't need such sophisticated equipment and analysis and all of that. We should just go and ask the tribals because they have a lot of wisdom which modern science does not have. So now I'll move on to the next part of my talk, which is studies on insect biology. There have been lots of questions asked about metabolomical questions asked about insect biology, like, you know, what is the effect of parasitism? How do severe environmental stresses affect the insect metabolome? What are the significant correlations between the phenotype, the metabolome and its phenotype, and so on? Okay, and NMR has led to a few success stories in this domain. What I'm going to talk about is, so I have collaboration with several evolutionary biologists, Professor Sudeep Day in ISA Pune, Professor Prasad at ISA Mohali, and Professor Shiba Vasu at JNCSR Bangalore. So with Professor Shiba, the question we asked was that, you know, can metabolites be associated with circadian rhythm in Drosophila melanogaster? Drosophila are fruit flies. And Shiba works on fruit flies which have mutated genes. So she's specifically interested in sleep, okay, and in biorhythms and in the circadian clock. So if what she does is, you know, knocks out one of the genes responsible for the circadian clock and then sees what effect or what response do the flies have when this happens. And so she just gave us a sample standard population, not with any mutated genes and things, and said, can one use NMR and, you know, detect the circadian rhythm? Can we look at certain metabolites which are associated with circadian rhythm? Then, so that's one study that I'm going to talk about. The other study I'm going to talk about is with Professor Sudeep Day, and that is the 4th bullet point. So Sudeep works on explorer flies. So he has, through generations and generations, he has mutated or he has taught fruit flies to disperse, that is to explore their environment. Okay, and I'll tell you a little bit about why. So we wanted to use Drosophila NMR and see whether, you know, there are metabolic differences in a normal population of flies and what I call explorer flies. Then the next two pieces of work that I'm going to talk about were done with Professor Prasad here at ISA Mohali, and Prasad has, you know, a population of fruit flies which have evolved to selection pressure for increased immunity. And so we wanted to look at, you know, how does the metabolome of the fruit fly, how has it evolved over 72 generations in response to their increased immunity? And by immunity, I mean immunity against a bacterial pathogen. And how does aging, so, you know, the older the fly gets, does its immune response go down in these increased immunity flies or not? And if, of course, it must go down with age, but does it go down to a lesser extent than the normal traditional population, okay, which is not immune selected? So let me begin with, and of course, you know, why choose Drosophila as a model organism? Because, you know, one can't ask such specific questions in human beings, and model organisms can, in fact, be a proxy for living organisms. So the kind of questions that one can ask and answer in a model organism, and there are several, Drosophila is just one model organism, can, you know, probably be transported to the more complex organisms like human beings. So, like I said, with Shiva, we began studying the circadian clock. And the idea was, you know, why study the clock? Because it has a very, it has a cyclic influence. We all know that there are, you know, some of us respond, we are day people, some of us are night people. And today's lifestyle is not really in sync with the evolutionary forces that shaped circadian clocks. And that's why you have metabolic disorders. So people, you know, binge watch Netflix movies and then order a pizza and drink alcohol really late at night, wake up late, and it throws their gut metabolism, it throws their sleep metabolism, everything completely out of sync. And that actually can lead to obesity, metabolic syndrome, diabetes, heart disease. There are lots and lots of risks when your clock is not in sync with your metabolome. So we wanted to see, so we looked at different blocks of flies, and we actually, you know, we did experiments on around 1,200 flies, which was quite a bit of work for my PhD student. And these flies were maintained under 12-hour light-dark cycles. And then, you know, at the 29th generation, the eggs were sampled. Then, of course, there's a lot of procedure that one has to go through to make them ready for NMR analysis. And we found that, you know, when we did the multivariate statistical analysis, there is a 10 to 12 hour cycling in a few metabolites. So there is a cycling in the metabolism which occurs. And we kept them in these light dark cycles to give them, and we gave them additional temperature cues. So at night, in quotes, the temperature dropped, and during the day, the temperature was higher. Okay. And so we were able to identify metabolites with which other people have also reported, and we call these circadian metabolites. And so these are the 14 identified metabolites. That's a polar dendrogram. I will not go into details of all the various metabolites and their cycles, but you can see that, you know, there's a light. So zero for, on the x-axis, you can see the, on the y-axis, you can see the levels of various metabolites. So there are these amino acids, leucine, isoleucine, lysine, tryptophan, and so on. Then there are fatty acids, there's glucose, there's NAD, there's lactic acid, and all of these have certain cycles in the fly. Okay, so what we've just done, this is like a pilot study where we've shown that, you know, we can identify rhythms, diurnal rhythms, which are correlated with concentrations of these specific metabolites. So the next thing that we have in mind is we're going to get mutated fruit fly populations from Shiba, which have something, you know, which have their diurnal rhythms disturbed. And then we're going to use NMR to see that what happens to those specific metabolites, what happens to the rhythms of those specific metabolites. Okay. Now I come to what we did with Professor Sutheeth from ISA Pune. And like I said, you know, the question was, question that can be asked is, you know, why do explorers explore? Why do you want to go beyond on your environment? Why climb a mountain? If you ask a mountaineer, he'll say, oh yeah, because it's there. He or she will say that. But evolutionary biologists have shown that dispersal, that is moving out of your environment, is actually a very favorable evolutionary strategy. And several organisms do this, and it's in response to selection pressure, which can be climate change or habitat degradation. And the organism disperses to a favorable habitat. And of course, you know, there, it also links to ecological scenarios. So one can have extinction of species from one, you know, point, time, place in space, which is correlated with another extinction. There can be kin competition and so on. So what are the ways in which ways in which organisms, you know, deal with these selection pressures? Is they emigrate from their natural or natal habitat. And So we'll see. And of course, this could lead to co-evolution of traits, life history traits, behavioral traits. And we wanted to see what is the dispersal effect on the metabolome. So, you know, what are the processes? Are there processes that get up or down regulated in response to selection pressure for dispersal? So what Suthi did was he began selecting explorer flies over several hundred generations. And so VB are the explorer flies and VBC is the control population. He trained them to explore. So typically, you know, fruit flies in the wild, they forage over around 20 meters. But by the time Suthirth had trained these explorer flies, they were exploring areas, space of 200 times more than their natural foraging space. So what he did was he began by putting them in a huge big bottle, which had a narrow funnel opening into a dark tunnel, which was a plastic pipe, which is coiled around and around, and it had a food source at the end. So the initial generations, the ones who somehow, you know, stumbled into this dark tunnel and then made it out at the end, found the food source and they survived. And then he kept selecting the survivors on and on and on. And finally, he found that these flies were actually predisposed to explore. So when you put these flies and a population of control flies, which are not selected for dispersal, for exploring, and you have, you know, food source, lighting, everything. So the environment, everything is fine with the environment. These guys would always look for the hole and always escape and always explore to see is there a better environment. Whereas the other flies who were part of the control population, they would be happy with their environment. If they had whatever food sources and things, they would not explore. And this was, you know, with a trial or statistics of 95%. So 95% of the explorer flies would actually go and find that opening and explore, even though there was no selection pressure to do so. So then we did various, and before that, he also did various tests on these flies and found that there were no physiological differences. So intelligence, learning, adaptability, aggression, to evaluate the fitness of these explorer flies, and they didn't find any physiological differences, nothing in the respiratory organs, nothing in their, so it ought to come down to, you know, what's in their brain, what have they been thinking, why are they predisposed to explore. And we did find clear differences using NMR between the VB and the VBC, the explorer and the control flies. So energy metabolism was definitely reprogrammed. They showed, you know, the explorer flies showed a 2.9-fold, threefold increase in glucose level. They're more active because, of course, they would require more energy. And they are, you know, respiration, glucose metabolism has been upregulated. There are other metabolic differences, which I will not go into right now. So their behavior, they were restless, there were no changes in life history really, but they were more aggressive. And this aggression or their behavior, we could relate to their metabolic differences, like in neurotransmitter and precursor levels. Okay, so the summary is that indeed, you know, we can look for and we found metabolic differences between explorer flies and control flies. Now I just move to the next part. I'm kind of running out of time. So let me quickly go through with what we've done with in collaboration with Professor Prasad at ISA Mohali. So like I said, Prasad looks at questions of aging and immunity and immune response. And he has, you know, over 72 generations evolved a population of fruit flies which have enhanced immunity. Okay. I think somebody's trying to send me a message. Am I audible? Hello? Hello?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible. Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
Oh. Okay. So the questions we asked was, that is the metabolome of populations which are selected for increased immunity, just like the explorer flies, are the immune enhanced flies, are they metabolically different at a basal level from the control populations? And these basal changes, how do they change under infected conditions? So they, you know, are they, the changes in the metabolome, so post-infection of these two populations, the immune enhanced and the control population, are they different? So these are the two kinds of questions we wanted to ask. The first is, of course, more basic, and the second was about immune response. So the selected populations were derived from the Blue Ridge baseline, which is one kind special kind of Drosophila, which is a lab line. And two regimes were created. So one was infected with a pathogen, which we call I, and S was sham infected. So that means it was just pricked with a needle. And this was the particular pathogen used for the infection. So NMR experiments were done on the flies after 40 generations of selection. And so we had, you know, we gave different kinds of treatments. So first we infected them with just a needle. Okay, with first we infected them by pricking with a needle dipped in the bacteria. So those are those two populations, II and SI. So we have the base population capital I and the base population S. So which is like the control, and I you can say is immune enhanced. Then we had II, which is the immune enhanced infected. Then we had the SI, which is sham or control, which is infected. Then we have IS and SS, which are sham infection with a needle, which is just a sterile needle. So it doesn't have the pathogen, because we wanted to see that, you know, there could be an immune response in the metabolites, which is due just to the pricking of the needle. So we wanted to separate that effect from the bacterial infection effect. And then we had these two basal populations uninfected. So IU and SU, which were not pricked with anything, neither with the bacteria nor with just the sterile needle. Okay. So those are the populations, those are the selection regimes, those are the treatments. Then we had, you know, for each treatment, we had six treatments, we had five replicates, and we had four experimental blocks. You can see 1 to 4 over there. So this was like a lot of flies, a lot of treatments, a lot of replicates, a lot of selection regimes, and a lot of work, hard work for the PhD students. But lo and behold, we did find, using quite sophisticated multivariate statistics, that there's a huge difference in the basal populations, okay, itself. So there's they have different metabolic signatures. The flies that have been evolved to have a better immune response to pathogen infection, and the control flies, or the untreated flies, things have changed. We are only talking about the metabolomic level. One doesn't know what has happened at the genetic level. But at the metabolomic level, definitely, you know, their response, metabolic response, is very different. The metabolic signature is very different. Okay, so these are all the levels of various metabolites. And we actually, you know, try to look at what kind of pathways in the metabolism can be correlated with the up or down regulation increased, enhanced or decreased. So you can see those little red triangles, which are upregulated, or they're, so proline, you know, in the enhanced immunity, enhanced flies has a greater level. I'm talking about the base level. And arginine similarly is upregulated, and so on and so forth. Myo-inositol is upregulated. So we kind of made this little chart of what are the pathways that are disturbed. I wouldn't say dysregulated, but which are, you know, changed in some sense by having these flies which have an enhanced immune response. And compared to the control populations, these immunity enhanced populations, they had higher levels of fatty acids, organic acids, amino acids, and they were better prepared to cope with infection. And post-infection, we found that, you know, they changed the concentrations of these threonine, myo-inositol, lactate, alanine, they changed differently, indicating that, you know, both these populations, they've evolved different responses to immune activation. Then we also identified, you know, metabolic pathways which get altered during adaptation to bacterial infection. And interestingly, we also found that, you know, the profiles associated with infection and with prick injury. Remember I told you that we had, you know, just a sterile needle, which is what is a prick injury. They showed that even, you know, in response to prick injury, there's a differential response to infection and to injury. And we have results, which I'm not showing them here, but we also, you know, tested these populations to infections against other pathogens. So you know, these were bred to be immune and having enhanced immunity for a particular pathogen population. But then we infected them with other pathogens, and we found that this enhanced immunity has led to cross tolerance. So they were able to tolerate infections from other types of pathogens, other types of gram-negative bacteria as well. Okay, so that's the summary. And overall, the push of selection seems to be to better prepare the metabolome. Then we wanted to go further and see, you know, we all know that aging leads to decline in the immune system. And the net activity, you know, is, so what happens in an immune-selected fly population? Does immune response in older flies affect the metabolome in the same way as in the control population? And are older immune-enhanced flies still able to withstand bacterial infection? So this is a study which is still ongoing, again in collaboration with Dr. Prasad. And we had now, apart from all those treatments and selection regimes, now we've added age. So we had young flies, middle-aged flies, and old flies. And each of these, you know, age populations were then treated. They were untreated, they had prick injury, and they had infected injury. So I won't bore you with the statistics, but definitely what we found was, I mean, at the moment, this is still ongoing, but we find that aging decreases immunity in both the control and the immune-selected populations. But the old immune-selected flies, they're still better able to withstand infection as compared to the basal fly population. So somehow the immunity, enhanced immunity, kind of does, it decreases with age, but it doesn't quite go away. Okay. So I now come to the end of my talk. And of course, you know, none of this would be possible without my PhD students and my master's students. So currently I have 8 students in my group, and 8 of them have graduated, and a couple of postdocs. Yeah. So, and I would like to acknowledge all my collaborators and my funding partners. I'm especially happy to acknowledge STARS MHRD. I just received funding from them this year for NMR metabolomics. So I'm done. Thank you. And I can take questions.
Thank you, ma'am, for such an informative talk. So we can say NMR is an indispensable tool in not only chemistry and physics, but also in biology. Definitely. So now the house is open for a question session.
Ma'am, I want to ask, can NMR spectroscopy distinguish COVID-19 patients?
It depends on what you mean by distinguish COVID-19 patients. So if, you know, definitely along with other techniques, if one looks at their blood profiles, then one could do so. But is there a, you know, NMR-based diagnostic test which will immediately distinguish? At the moment, no. But I believe that there are several labs which are, you know, moving towards this. So hopefully sometime in the future.
Okay, ma'am. And how much sample do we need to run NMR?
Yeah, so we don't need very much. The concentration of the sample is important. So typically 1 millimolar.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. ओके एनी अदर क्वेश्चन बेटा? One of the participant want to ask, is there any size limit for detecting biological samples like proteins through NMR?
Sorry, what size limit?
Is there any size limit like we can determine?
Yeah. So at the moment, you know, as far as proteins goes, NMR can handle comfortably up to 30 to 40 kilodalton. Beyond that, you know, is difficult, but there are many techniques now where people are going to higher and higher magnetic fields, doing isotope labeling, and lots of NMR techniques, in, like I said, two-dimensional, three-dimensional, n-dimensional have come up. So the size limit is being pushed every day.
Okay, ma'am. Another query from Bhuvan Sharma.
Yes.
Can we detect lead-like substances in soil through NMR?
One can detect lots of toxic pollutants, and people are doing a lot of studies on things like cadmium, which are, you know, heavy metals where a lot of farmers are growing, you know, having to grow plants like spinach, you know, palak, methi, and muli, radish, in soil which is actually emerging from waste plants. So there's a lot of industrial toxic metals, and there are a lot of NMR studies now on that. Lead especially I'm not aware of, but other heavy metals definitely.
Any other question from the participants?
Hello.
Hi.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Ma'am, why do we use tetramethylsilane as an NMR spectroscopy as a solvent?
It's used not as a solvent, it's used as a standard. So like I said, when, you know, NMR is all about the frequencies, right? So if I have one particular, TMS is one solvent which always, it doesn't interact much with other molecules, and it always resonates at one particular point. So one usually takes that as the zero or the reference, and then calibrates the spectrum with respect to that.
Thank you, ma'am.
You're welcome.
It looks like we have covered all the doubts regarding the NMR spectroscopy. Once again, I thank you, ma'am, for sparing us your valuable time. Now I would like to invite head of the Department of Chemistry and co-coordinator, Professor Kamalpreet Kaur, for a word of thanks.
Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
Distinguished speaker, Dr. Kavita Dorai, coordinator, Professor Pradeep Kaur, my fellow faculty members and dear students, it's a matter of great privilege to propose a vote of thanks on culmination of yet another educative and memorable session. To know the unknown is the foremost step towards exploring the world around us. Recognizing the building blocks of life is a huge step in knowing the very essence of life. And spectroscopy helps us in achieving just that. Today's lecture on NMR spectroscopy by Dr. Kavita was full of knowledge. It gave us a deep insight into the subject and also revealed some interesting facts, starting from the basics of NMR spectroscopy to the applications of NMR spectroscopy in the field of biology, chemistry, pharmaceutical, in the field of geophysics, and to find out the structure of proteins, brine pocket, profile of groundwater, in drug designing, biomedical imaging, and then about the more recent applications of this technique in the field of metabolomics in disease diagnostics and metabolome evolution. The talk was very informative and enlightening. Sorry, ma'am. I'm pretty sure that the precious knowledge shared by Dr. Kavita will definitely help everybody in their resolve to understand the subject. On behalf of Mata Gujari College, I thank our guest speaker, Professor Kavita, for being with us and to spare time out of her busy schedule to grace this event. Thank you, ma'am, for such a wonderful talk on NMR spectroscopy and its biological applications. I would like to express my sincere thanks to our principal, Dr. Kashmir Singh, for providing encouragement and support. My profound gratitude to the coordinator, Professor Pradeep, for amazing leadership and smooth running in this seminar. I extend my appreciation to Dr. Gurpreet for making all the necessary arrangements and enormous cooperation throughout the event. I would also like to thank the faculty members taking time out of their curriculum to allow students to take part in this workshop. This workshop wouldn't be possible without their support. And finally, big thanks to the students for patient and enthusiastic listening. Once again, all for your cordial cooperation. Great day.
Thank you. Thank you very much.